This is Teed Up. Teed Up, Brooke.
Welcome to Tee It Up, and this episode is brought to you by Pro Skate Corner, located in Toronto, Ontario. And friendly reminder to all our listeners in the Toronto area, head over to Pro Skate Corner for all your skating equipment needs. Jeff Potter, close friend of the show, he'll take care of you. Brooke, how's it going this week?
Not too bad, Lindsay. I'm doing all right. I got my hair done this week for the first time since June. Thank you, coronavirus. But you know what? It was worth the wait, but it was great. I'm here in New Hampshire, been here for the past 2 weeks. I got one more week left and I'm going back down to Jersey. Hopeful that we're going to get to go back on the ice. But again, we're not sure right now, but as everyone says, stay in shape. So that's the hardest part, but otherwise not too bad. Been playing pond hockey up here, which is great because down in New Jersey, it hasn't been as cold. So we got some really good ice up here. Going ice fishing this weekend, taking advantage of the nice outdoors up here in New Hampshire. So just living it up, working still, but taking advantage of some time with some family and friends. So how about you, Linz? How you doing?
Right on. And I was going to say, I noticed you looking a little blonder this week.
Yeah.
Very nice. Very nice. I'm at home as well. I'm back in Ottawa for the week. Just like you said, taking this time before we get back at it with practices, because you never know what's going to happen here in the coming months with hockey. So like you said, staying in it, staying ready. But yeah, just getting some TLC at home. I'm getting my hair done this week too.
Just, hey.
what the things you got to do while you're home. I bought a car. I mean, my big girl purchase, really.
Let's see.
A little Toyota HCR. Yeah. Oh no. CHR. I can't even know what it's called.
Yeah.
So, big girl purchase. It's white. My favorite color.
Damn, you're going to be driving a white car. White cars actually look very slick. I will give you that. They don't look as dirty in the wintertime, which is nice. They still they get this occasional dirt and salt and all that stuff, but much easier to keep it clean. I drive a black car and I have to go to the car wash like every other day. So
thank you. So the budget, I gotta adjust the budget. And actually shout out Trapper Goldsmith. He's my financial advisor and he works with professional athletes and make sure we get on track with our finances and look ahead to our future. So he helps me out with all my finances and stuff. So I gotta book an appointment with him ASAP to get things straight away again. So we that's definitely a guest that we gotta have on. He's awesome and has a lot of energy, and I think he'd have a great message for all of us.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we were just talking about this earlier. You know, it's that time of the year where, you know, we're a couple months into 2021, trying to stick to our budgets, our New Year's resolutions and all that stuff. So budget is it needs to be a little bit higher up on the priority list, but we're working on it.
Yes, exactly.
So that's good.
So that's about all for me. I got to skate on the canal while I've been home. Did a 15 kilometer skate the other day, went down and back. So feeling that one a little. It's been a couple of weeks. It's been on the wheels. So it was fun. It was a nice skate, beautiful day for it with my friend Ian. And it was awesome. So if you're ever in Ottawa, that's a must do.
I know. I remember when I went up there for Canadian Thanksgiving, my first year at Syracuse. And I remember you showed us around Ottawa and I remember the canal. So
yes, not frozen
at that point, but you're right. So are there a lot of people that do that?
Oh my gosh. It was packed today. Honestly, really? It was un-COVID friendly, but I mean, you're outside, you're keeping your distance, but there's a lot of people around. But speaking of frozen ice surfaces, the Lake Tahoe games are going on this weekend, and pretty crazy what happened yesterday, Brooke, if you want to break that down for us.
Yeah, I was shocked, honest. I shouldn't have been shocked, but I was. So for anybody that didn't watch, there's two games going on this weekend. So yesterday, so we're recording on Sunday, so the Bruins and the Flyers play this evening, but yesterday Colorado and Vegas played, and the game was scheduled for 3:00, I believe. And beautiful day, like Lake Tahoe, the scenery is phenomenal. You gotta see the pictures, like they are absolutely stunning. So they started to play the first period, and it was 1-0 after the first. They came off the ice, but as you watch some of the clips, you could see, like, one of the refs toe picked. And you were like, oh, yeah, the ref, like, whatever. You probably can't skate. But then you start seeing players, like, toe picking as they're going to the ice. You're like, okay, like, yeah, like.
Same clip.
Yeah, it's inevitable. Like, you're outside. It's Mother Nature. Like, it's the elements, whatever. So after that, I was saying, I was like, this intermission seems very long. So, because they weren't updating anybody. So we got the update on TV and they were like, yeah, we're going to, we're making a decision in the next 15 minutes because of, I know there was a difference. The biggest differences was the sun glare, like from like on the ice and just the ice conditions to begin with. So the ice was really soft. The ice or the sun was glaring on it. Like it was hard for the players to see the puck and all this and that. So they ended up rescheduling the game until midnight Eastern time last night. And I tried so hard to stay up. So they got to play two periods after that. So they didn't call it a complete game. But I watched the first period and I was like, yes, I did it. I stayed up. I didn't take a nap or anything. And I fell asleep for the third period. I was so mad at myself. But so they resumed last night. And then Boston and Philadelphia are actually set to play. So it's 7:07 right now. They're probably getting ready to hit the ice. So we'll tune into that game just after this, but I am extremely jealous. It looks so fun. I actually played at Frozen Fenway my senior year at Syracuse, or excuse me, at St. Paul's in high school. And it was so much fun, but I definitely see what they're saying about the glare because
got to get the eye black on. Brooke knows all about that eyeliner.
There was a goalie that was wearing sunglasses underneath. Oh my God. I saw his that. Mask. It was so funny. But relatable. I have very sensitive eyes. So like anything that bounce, like, especially during the summertime too, like if you're near the pool or the water, I have to wear sunglasses. Cause I like, I'm squinting. I can't see, but it's the same off of the snow. Mm-hmm. So it was just insane. So I totally feel that. But after when they were playing at nighttime, a lot of the players were like, yeah, it feels like pond hockey. So I thought that that was pretty cool. So.
Honestly, both getting to see it during the day and at nighttime is pretty cool. But unfortunately, right now it's cutting into this, our recording time.
I know. I was so mad. As a
you had it all timed out and scheduled, and here we go. Here we are.
I know. But you know what? We can watch replays of it too. Like I'm only gonna miss probably the first period, so it's fine. I still get it happened to me last night. You know, you win some, you lose some. So.
Yeah, exactly. But could you imagine being those guys yesterday? You play a period and then you have to go into the locker room, get undressed, go about your day, and then come back, warm up again, get dressed again. Like I would hate that.
I know. Well, I heard on the broadcast too, shout out to Mike Tirico, Syracuse alum, did a phenomenal job. But I heard on the broadcast that they said that if they had played two periods, it would have been a complete game. They wouldn't have had to play the third period. But since they only played one, they had to play a second. So yeah, it's just like a total, like your mindset is off. That's tough as a player. Like you got to keep your head in the game and stuff. So yeah, it's taxing mentally.
It is.
That's all right. But speaking of Syracuse alum, we have another orange in the house. We're very, very excited to have him in today. His name is Steve Goldstein, and he is the play-by-play announcer for the Florida Panthers. And again, Newhouse graduate, which Lindsay and I are both proud alumni of. And we are so excited to have Steve on today. We're going to talk about his experience as a broadcaster, his experience with men's and women's hockey, because as we both know, he was the voice in the bubble also, which was great. So we're going to talk to him a little bit about that. We'll talk to him about Syracuse stuff and just like life in general, because that's what we do here on Teed Up. We love to just spill the tea, see what's up. And here's Steve. Hello, Steve. How are you?
Hey, how you guys doing? What's up?
Not too bad. We were just giving you a very hefty intro. So as Syracuse does, we pipe up our alumni. We're very proud to have you on today.
Newhouse Mafia.
Yep. We love, especially Newhouse. We are obviously the best. So, you know, not biased or anything. But Steve, where are you tuning in from today?
I am at home in South Florida. So
not bad.
We've been doing a lot of these over the last year on Zoom. So I got a little, very little setup here. So it doesn't look so terrible, and that's it.
Yeah.
All right on.
That's awesome. Yeah. So we were just, like I was saying, we gave you an intro, Florida Panthers, NWHL bubble, Olympics, like you've done it all. So as female hockey players, obviously we want to know, you know, what was your first impression of calling a women's hockey game? Because as players, we hear all the time how different our games actually are, not just physically, but tactically too. So I think we're both interested to hear, you know, how is that, you know, as an analyst of the game and keeping up with the speed and calling that for everyone to watch.
Well, the first time I did any women's hockey was 2010 in Vancouver at the Olympics. And then I did it in 14 also. You know, I love it. I really treat it. It's the same for me as doing, you know, if I'm doing like an NHL playoff game or doing a Panthers game on TV. I mean, you know, you guys are pros, great athletes, you know, great dedication. I know the coaches, you know, take it extremely seriously. So that's the way I approached, you know, I remember, you know, Kevin Dineen used to coach the Panthers. And then, of course, he went on to coach Team Canada to that gold medal. You know, those Canadian fans, good for you. But, man, that was heartbreaking. I remember talking to him, and when I was preparing for that, for those games, it was the same as when Kevin Dineen coached the Panthers. So I really treat it the same. You know, I thought the level of play was great, you know, always at the Olympics, but in the NWHL, in the bubble in Lake Placid, I really thought the enthusiasm and the team concept and the way everybody played, I thought it was terrific competition.
Oh, thank you. Well, we appreciate that. So what would you say is the biggest difference from men's and women's game?
You know, for me calling the game, it's not a huge difference. Obviously the men's game, you know, in the NHL, I mean, they are literally flying. I mean, these guys are, you can't get everything in. On TV, it's a little easier because you don't need to say everything. On radio, you know, much different. Calling game on radio, you're the eyes, you know, of the listener. So you've got to be a lot more descriptive, you know, say left wing, right wing, you know, over the blue line. On TV, you know, you don't need to say all of those things because, you know, the viewer, the fan can actually see what's going on. But that would really be, in my mind, that's really the only difference. I think it's great, and I hope the women's game continues to grow.
Yeah. I actually, I took a play-by-play class last year, and it's not easy. It's no joke. I had to call football. Like, we'd have to go to high school football games and do like a 5-minute tape. And I struggled because football is not really my forte. And then finally we got into basketball, and you could either do basketball or hockey. So I went over to the Crunch game and did my tape there. But even I know the game, like what I thought, like at a professional level, but that it's really different when it comes to calling it and doing the play-by-play.
Yeah. You have to really disseminate and think in the moment of what to leave out. That's a big part of it, because you can't say everything. So for example, like your games, and by the way, you may think I'm just saying this because you're here, but one of my biggest thrills was your goal, the first goal in Toronto history. So I thought it was awesome calling that. I mean, it was a great shot and, you know, historic, the first goal in franchise history. And obviously on the broadcast, you know, I was saying, you know, talking about Syracuse hockey and all that. So that was actually a thrill for me. You may not believe it, but I'm serious. It was.
Oh, thank you.
It was right up there with Jagr passing Brett Hull 5 years ago. And I called.
Get out of here. That's fans. Cool.
Yeah, it's right there. But yeah, you have to think in the moment. So when you guys were in the bubble, you know, we weren't there live. So we're calling the game off a monitor, and especially the Boston Pride, when they wear those yellow jerseys, it's hard to see the numbers. It really is. So you got a lot of, you know, you'll have a great play, maybe a cross ice pass, and, you know, and it goes in the net, and you're like, they score, and you can't immediately see who it is. So you need to kind of figure out, like, in that moment, that's just one example of, and you know, because, you know, you did a little bit of it, you know, how quickly you need to figure out what you can say, what you shouldn't say, what to leave out. You know, you just have to, I guess it just takes years and years of, you know, practice to really perfect it, but it's something you always have to work on.
Mm-hmm. Oh, for sure. And I actually, that's so cool how technology, you can do those broadcasts remotely and do them from home. I was actually I did the analyst. I was the color for the Syracuse women's game, hockey game on Friday. And like you said, it's really hard to see those jerseys, like the numbers on the jerseys from like your little screen. And like, luckily for me, I know, you know, what the Syracuse girls, I could tell by their ponytail who's who or the way they skate, but from the other team, they're playing Long Island University. That's not easy. That's it's crazy.
Yeah. And I started to pick it up, like you just said, in the NWHL games, after a few games, I finally started to pick up, you know, I could tell some players, by different traits, the way they skate, you know, size or, you know, the ponytail, whatever it is. So I finally started to pick that up. But yeah, it's not easy. It's, but it's pretty amazing. You're right that, you know, I'm sitting in a studio, you know, by the beach in Florida, calling your games while you guys are up in Lake Placid, and, you know, and it's doable. I mean, it's much better being there, but it's certainly doable. And the average person out there probably doesn't notice the difference. That's the other interesting thing. You know, I notice a big difference, but the average person probably would.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. Well, I find it really interesting, you know, this whole thing about the technology piece and all that. But so as a player, you know, I grew up, I was like, I'm going to be a broadcaster. Like, that's what I want to do. Mm-hmm. So I went to UNH for 2 years and they had a great program where I could do that. And as I started to do it, I was like, you know, I don't love my voice. I don't love being on camera, all that kind of stuff. So I'm interested to hear, because doing that, I was like, I was very critical of myself. And I feel like a lot of people that are in this field are the same way. So I'm interested to hear if you ever received, not necessarily like a negative criticism, but what, you know, colleagues have said, you know, what you can work on or what you're really good at and how you took that moving forward, especially for people that are either trying to get into the field or that have something that they might be insecure about, but know that they have the passion to keep moving forward, but there's something just holding them back.
It's a great question. You know, you guys playing, you know, being high level athletes, you know, you're used to that and you welcome the constructive criticism and you get it sometimes if you don't even want it from coaches and sometimes teammates if they're holding you accountable. Right. So you're used to that. You know, there's a lot of people out there. Okay. And the people you associate with, like the two of you, you're used to it. It's no problem. You know, and you probably appreciate it. If someone tells you, hey, you know, you might want to hold the stick this way, it's good. And you're like, wow, okay, great. Thanks. A lot of people out there that get insulted by that. They don't want to be told. They don't want the constructive criticism. So I always welcome it. I feel like in broadcasting, it's hard to actually get it because everybody's so busy. Everybody's doing their own thing. And a lot of times people are reluctant to say, you know, I'll ask different people, you know, over the years, hey, you know, what do you think I can do better? What do you think we can be better at? And very rarely do you really get anything good. So it's actually a difficult thing to get in the broadcasting business. You know, there was one time, I think I was probably 2-3 years out of Syracuse, and there was a new sports radio. So this is when sports radio was really getting started, and they started a station in Washington, D.C. So I knew of the guy, and, you know, this is before, literally before email, internet. So if you wanted to get your tape to someone, you had to make a cassette tape and put it in the mail and send it to the guy. And he called me up. He said, Steve, I've known you. I like you a lot, but you may want to look into doing something else off the air. It's just not good enough. So, which was fine. I wasn't mad. I mean, he's entitled to his opinion. But that's one that I always remembered. So I guess because I always remember it, it kind of fueled me a little bit. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, you know, people have been very, very encouraging. But yeah, to answer your question, I like more constructive criticism. It's actually hard to find. It is.
Yeah. Oh, right on. And so what made you want to go into broadcasting and play by play?
A great question, Lindsay. You know, ever since I was a little kid, I don't know why, like I was 8-9 years old. I'd go to games with my dad and like, wait, everyone's waiting for players out. I'd wait for the announcers, try to talk to them. I know it's strange. When I grew up, there was no cable TV. Keep this in mind. There's a whole different era back in the 80s. I didn't grow up in like the 50s or 60s, but you know, in the 80s, it was all just getting started. So I used to sit home and I'd listen to Rangers home games were never on television. So I'd listen to Ranger games on the radio. And then when they were on TV, the road games, I'd turn the sound down and announce the game to myself or into a tape recorder. So when I was growing up, like my heroes were, you know, Marv Albert. There was a guy named Bob Murphy, did the Mets for many years. And some of the things I even say or how I say them are because of those guys. And I know I'm not alone in that. There are a lot of people that are about my age that did sports broadcasting in the same boat. But, you know, it was one of those things back then. You know, I grew up in Brooklyn and there really wasn't that much else to do. Like it was sports. You know, there was no internet and we had some video games, you know, the old Atari and stuff like that. But there was no, you know, PlayStation. So what we did was play sports. And, you know, my dad used to take me to games and I just became a big sports junkie. And, just always wanted to announce games. And luckily, and a lot of it's luck. You got to be in the right time, right, right place, right time. But luckily, a lot of it's worked out.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's great. That's awesome. Yeah, I know for us especially too, like this podcast has been great for us. It's a really great learning experience. And with every episode, we debrief it, we go over it. But I know probably for both of us too, Lindsay, we're really interested in the prep that goes on behind the scenes, because I know like when I was doing it, I did some lacrosse games, basketball, stuff like that. It's like, you got to research every player. You got to do this and that. I know people make like big scorecards and stuff to keep track of the numbers. So what does your prep look like when you go into
it? Hey, you got to hang on 1 second. Give me 5 seconds. Okay. 5 seconds. Okay. Literally. Oh. Five. Four,
he's been a prop. He's three, been a prop.
Two, one. Okay. Here we go.
Yes. That's what it is.
All right. Hang on. Let me find Toronto. There we go. So here's Toronto from the bubble. Okay. I had that. And then I have these sheets also, which give me like the lines and all that stuff. So here's that. And then I've got all this stuff. Now, remember when I started doing the games in the bubble, where's 44? There we go. Syracuse University, rookie, good shot. I forget who told me that. I talked to so many people like getting information with the league and stuff. So someone told me I had a good shot. CHA Defender of the Year as a rookie, as a senior, I mean. Alio is your teammate, and so is Megan Quinn, which I knew. So wait, where's my Metropolitan one? I got Minnesota. And then I have these sheets, which are bigger and tell you all the lines.
Okay.
So I have those that I fill in. And like I said, I do the same stuff for, here's the game that got canceled. The empty sheet, the whale and the white caps.
Yep.
So anyway, so this is exactly what I do for the NHL games. And I did it, with you guys. This one though, I was coming in blind. You know, I had only known of a couple of players in the league. So I was really like starting baseline. Luckily, there were people with the league that were great and, give you some information as it got closer. But I was a little nervous. Like 2 weeks before, I knew like 3 players on each team. That's it. And I'm like, when am I going to get all this stuff? So that's all the prep. I do a lot of charts and things like that. And just, you don't get to a lot of the stuff when you do it, but you have it just in case. And that's the part, like for me, that's fun. See, I know it's really weird, but like I must have made those up. I probably did like 3 versions of those before I had the full one for each team. Wow. But I enjoy that. That's the fun part of it, finding out information. Like in the NWHL case, doing you guys justice, because you're pros. It's a professional league. It's a professional game. It's a job. And it's not like just some fun rec league game. So I treat it like an NHL game as far as doing the background and doing the homework to do it, the way you're supposed to do it. And I really enjoyed it.
Oh no. And we appreciate all that goes into it. I know like that's cool to see it showing us that. That's awesome. Yeah. But who's someone who's been your favorite color commentator or partner in the booth so far?
Great question. I've had a lot of partners and I pretty much like everybody, especially when I do hockey, all these guys, everybody I've done it with is a former player. They're all hockey junkies. For the most part, they all want to be better on the air. Everybody's different. Some think they're good the way they are and, don't give me any advice. Some ask for advice. Not that I'm one to just give advice, but I've been doing it a long time. So really, it would be hard for me to pick. I'm doing the games now in the Panthers with Randy Moeller, who used to play for the Rangers and the Sabres and the Quebec Nordiques. He's been with the Panthers forever. We did radio together years ago. So once you've known someone that long and you're friendly off the air, it just carries over onto the air. It was pretty cool for me growing up a Ranger fan doing the games with Denny Potvin, because Ranger fans hate Dennis Potvin. we used to chant Potvin sucks at Madison Square Garden, like literally the big joke I had with him for all the years, because he's a terrific guy. We go to dinner on the road and he says, I know you were actually yelling Potvin's cups, not Potvin sucks. So that was his, big joke. At the Olympics, I did game with John Van Beesbroek, who, got to know and obviously does a lot with USA Hockey. Brett Hedekin is another guy that I worked with He played for the Panthers. I was at the Olympics with him, and he was an Olympian himself. So, but yeah, everybody I've done games with has been terrific. You know, these guys are all, you know how it is for the most part, especially in this sport. You got a lot of really good people. You know, I think it's more the exception when you find someone, you're like, I'm not 100% on that person. I think it's most of the time you find people are really great.
Yeah, that's true. I agree with you. I've never heard somebody put it like that, but I think you're totally spot on with, like, our hockey community is so close, and everyone loves each other for the most part. There's a, like,
except for me and Bruins fans, we don't love each other.
Oh yeah, stab. That's a direct shot. Right there.
I can respect that though. I like.
Of course, everyone who's not from Boston doesn't like Boston, and it's fine. I'm not mad. Just disappointed, but it's fine. So speaking of, I love how. So, for example, Nashville has been this huge, like, story in the past couple of years. Comes from really not being that successful of a program into this massive hockey town, and people love to go to the games. And now with Tampa Bay winning in Florida, I feel like, you know, Florida hockey's been on the map, and Tampa Bay especially is establishing themselves. But I think that, you know, this similar story of hockey in Florida, like, people don't think of hockey in warm places, to be honest with you. So I am interested to hear how the hockey culture is specifically with the Panthers, but in the state of Florida too.
You know, it's been an ongoing, I hate to use the word battle, but like an uphill thing, you know, since the late 90s, because it was new, you know, and you got a lot of people that had never seen a game, but people were very enthusiastic about it. Now it's just taken off. I mean, you got guys, you know, you got players in the NHL that were born in Florida. You got players that came through, played for the Junior Panthers. I mean, there's a number of players in the league. I mean, Jacob Chychrun, you know, his dad's Jeff. He actually worked with us in the Panther broadcast. You know, he grew up in Boca Raton, and Jeff coached him and Riley Stillman. They were on the same team. Riley's now with the Panthers playing in Syracuse with the Crunch. So they were on the same Junior Panthers team. Chase Prisky, you know, who's now in the AHL. He grew up and played at Quinnipiac. You know, he grew up, you know, playing in Florida. Shane Gostisbehere. So you're starting to get these guys that are from here. I know the high school league. My son played high school hockey here. He's now in college. But high school league is, you know, thriving on both coasts. Obviously, Tampa has won more than the Panthers have. So from a fan standpoint, I mean, they've sold out, I think it's 234, 235 consecutive games over there. Because, you know, they've been cup contender and then won the cup. But here with the Panthers, you know, on the East Coast, you know, people, when they win, you know, you have to win. You know, Florida is one of those places, you know, everybody for the most part is from somewhere else. There's a ton to do. So, you know, in the middle of January on a Saturday night, you got to give people a reason to go to the hockey game because they could sit outside by the beach and have a steak. So, you know, you got to either love hockey or give people a reason to go, but it's been amazing. And, you know, the youth programs here just continue to grow. You know, the girls hockey programs continue to grow. So it's really great to see. And, you know, the more people that move to Florida from places up north, it's obviously growing more because those people are, you know, come down as hockey fans.
For sure. For sure. That's interesting to see how it's growing and the game, the sport of hockey, I think is really growing in the States. I know in Canada, we have no issue with that, but over there it's spreading out to other states like Florida. So that's cool to see, but bringing it back to Syracuse. So what's your greatest memory at Syracuse?
Oh boy. Those are not podcast worthy, but no.
It's friendly here.
We have plenty of non-podcast worthy stories as well. So don't
do. I remember taking the classes at Newhouse where the full day we have to put on a newscast. So I always remember, you know, there's a director, technical director, producer, person, news anchor, sports anchor. And I remember always switching with people to be the sports anchor. So there were like 20 weeks of it. I think I was the sports anchor like 14 or 15 times because there were a lot of people that didn't want to do it. They were scared. I don't know anything about sports. I do remember that. But what I really remember is doing the games. You know, I worked at WAER when Syracuse football was great. Basketball was great. And we went to Big East tournaments. You know, I called a game against Georgetown with 33,000 people in the Carrier Dome. Billy Owens, was a great player at the time, got fouled at the buzzer. So he had to make both free throws to send the game into overtime. So he's all alone at the free throw line because there's literally no time left. He makes both three free throws. Syracuse wins it. It was the final game of the year for the Big East Championship. And we're right on the court, you know, at a table announcing the games. And literally people are jumping over us and stepping on our table to rush the court. So I'll never forget that.
That's cool.
The sound sounded like when you're like at the beach and a big wave comes, you know, that's what it sounded like. It was like a big wave of sound. And, you know, the Carrier Dome was just a great venue for noise. We got to go to Maui. Syracuse basketball played in the Maui Invitational. So we got on the trip. So here we are, like college kids at 20 years old. We're staying at the Maui Marriott pool and announcing basketball games. I mean, unbelievable stuff. Yeah, so those are some of the memories. And just, you know, regular college stuff, you know, is a lot of guys that I went to school with. They're now broadcasting. So, you know, you make those lifelong, you know, friends. And Syracuse was just a great place. I mean, I do remember freezing a lot, though. As you know, it's walking across campus. It was damn cold. I actually remember when the bar 44s opened, the night it opened up, I was there. I don't even know if 44s is still there, but that was a big spot. They opened a bar named after, you know, the famous jersey number 44. So, as you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I know there's a bar in New York. I don't remember what it's called, but it's something similar. It's a Syracuse bar. And I don't know if it's 44s or it's something very similar, I think, because everyone's like, if you're in New York, you have to go to this bar and watch the games. And I'm like, hey, I'll go, but I never remember the name. So when I find it, I will tell you. And I'm
always good. I want to know. The other thing I do remember is, so the first Iraq war, because it wasn't, but the first, you know, invasion, if you will, Syracuse basketball played a game that night. I think it was 90 or 91. And they announced, in the Carrier, I remember we were playing Connecticut, UConn. It's a big game, you know, UConn was fifth in the country, Syracuse was second. Those Big East games back then were like, you know, all out brawls. There were nine teams in the league. You know, everybody was great. They had all the great coaches and, you know, Boeheim and Lou Carnesecca and Big John Thompson with Georgetown. I mean, Big East basketball in the 80s and 90s was an entity of itself. And they announced in the Carrier Dome that the war had begun. And I guess people brought American flags because you saw like probably 10 or 15 American flags start waving and the whole Carrier Dome explode. Everybody was cheering back. Yeah, I thought that was really, and that's something I always remember that night. It was probably it was either 90 or 91. Yeah.
Wow, that's very cool. That's interesting.
Yeah, it's wild, right?
Yeah, wow. Well, that's, I know Brooke and I, we have had plenty of memories, and I miss that place so much, too. It's a special place. I bleed orange. That's why I'm wearing number 44. Respect my roots at Syracuse. But I guess before we let you go, what's one final piece of advice for us as, you know, aspiring broadcasters or any other aspiring broadcaster?
You know, obviously we get asked that a lot, you know, and I asked that when I was an intern at WFAN radio, when it first started one summer, I asked one of the on-air hosts, hey, you have any advice for me? You know, I was like 18 years old. And he says, never say no. If you want to be the play-by-play person for Monday Night Football on ESPN and ESPN asks you to clean the bathroom on the weekends, say yes and clean the bathrooms on the weekends. Get your foot in the door. I'll always remember that. And that's worked well for me. The other thing is, you know, if you have the passion, just believe in it, you know, because if you love something enough and you care enough, I still believe, even though we're in kind of a crazy world these days, I still believe there's people in charge that want people that have the hunger and the desire, you know? So I think that's it. And the other thing big for me, I'm a stickler on it, you got to be on time. You know, you can't be one of these people that shows up late. Well, you guys know, like, what happens if you show up late for practice? You know, not only is your coach mad, but yeah, but you know, you're disrespecting your teammates, right? You're basically saying my time is more valuable than your time. So that's another big thing for me, you know, be there. And if you love doing it, you know, I don't think having a good attitude is really a problem because you're going to have a good attitude.
Mm-hmm. Oh, for sure. For sure. Well, this has been great. Thank you so much, Steve. And we love having you here. And that was great to hear your voice on the broadcast. You did a great job. So thank you very much and all the best moving forward.
I appreciate it. It's been great to be with you guys. You guys are celebrities to me. So good luck in your careers, you know, on the ice, off the ice, everything you do, and hopefully we'll stay in touch.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks, Steve.
Thanks.
All right. Thanks for having me. See ya.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Oh, that was great. You know, like, it's so great when you can talk to people who actually watch our sport, appreciate the sport, what, like, go in depth with the sport, analyze the sport. Like, it's great. And that's the thing. You never really get to see people sometimes because they're always the voice behind. Mm-hmm. And it's great. And everything that he said too is very, very applicable. So I love the pieces of advice that he gave at the end.
Yeah, absolutely. And it, honestly, I love talking to other people that go to Q's. Like, I bleed orange. Like, it's crazy.
But everybody does. Everybody loves Syracuse. Like,
I know. So
our alumni network is amazing.
Yes, absolutely. No, that was pretty cool. And just, you know, knowing, I remember hearing that he was on the call and then he was a Syracuse alum. I was like, that is so cool. Like, he's going to be called, like, that's that. I just geek out about that stuff, but no, he was awesome. And, but we have a couple things we need to get to here about women's sports. Naomi Osaka beat Serena Williams this week.
Yeah. Which is crazy because you have Naomi, who's the highest played female athlete last year against Serena, one of the best, like honestly, probably the GOAT of all time.
Yeah, absolutely.
With women's tennis, and like, was a phenomenal match. And I don't think it mattered who won that game or that match, to be honest with you, because the competition was incredible. So mm-hmm. that was great.
And I saw a quote from Naomi that she said, I hope I play long enough that I play against another girl who says that she grew up looking up to me. Cause that's basically what she's saying about Serena. Like, that one hits close to home for me. I think that's so special and so amazing. And you know, I think about that all the time, like just like with girls that are older than me and I'm playing hockey, and it's like, wow, this is, I grew up watching you and looking up to you, and now we're playing against each other and stuff. So it's pretty cool.
I know, it's awesome. And to have those role models is just incredible. So mm-hmm. I'm with you on that. And hopefully we get to be those people too. You know, I mean, I think it's very applicable for us to be role models, even for, you know, I have kids in town. I come from a very small town and they're like, oh, like, you're awesome. And I'm like, oh, thank you. So I think what she said is just so awesome. So we really love to see that. And again, more major titles are coming up. So that'll be very exciting to see in the coming months. And then another big piece of news. I come from a New Hampshire ski, like town. New Hampshire's big on skiing. So Michaela Schifrin just participated in the World Cup Alpine Skiing, I guess they call it a tournament, out in Italy. She was in four events and medaled in all four, so huge congratulations to her, and we wish her the best, and we'll definitely see her in Beijing in 2022, so that's very exciting as well. And then we have Ashlyn Harris and Allie Krieger on the U.S. Women's National Team adopted a newborn baby, Sloan, and we are just so happy to see that too, because obviously we are very proud of any female athlete, but especially when they're making huge moves for inclusivity and diversity and, you know, just saving the world. So we're really happy to see that.
Oh, that's awesome to see. I love hearing stories about that. It warms the heart.
Yeah, absolutely. So unfortunately we're out of time this week, but we'll definitely catch up again on the next episode of Tee It Up. But for now, we're going to sign off. But again, for anybody that doesn't remember, get out to Pro Skate Corner for all your basic hockey needs. But anything in the greater Toronto area, get up there, go get your stuff done. And we will see you all next time on the next episode.